Jumping off into some new content now. We're going to talk about preparing the camera and we're going to talk about manual exposure. And Lee, I'd recommend you sort of follow along with your camera if you'd like to and try and find some of these things while we're going. I might be able to give you a hand if you can't find anything. So there are a few things that we're going to set up in the camera, and we're also going to talk about manual exposure too. How to read the correct exposure, how to adjust the exposure, and also some different trains of thought between handheld and tripod shooting. First thing is the image quality. We've got a choice between RAW and JPEG images. Now, I will say, I'm not sure if anyone's heard of a RAW format before. A RAW is by far a better quality photo. However, at this stage, I would recommend you shoot as a JPEG. Just because JPEGs they're easier to work with because they're a standardized image format. If you shoot in RAW, then you need to basically have a dedicated editing suite like Lightroom, okay? Your old version of Photoshop wouldn't work for any of the new cameras, Lee. There's a compatibility issue. So JPEGs tend to make things a bit easier. And if we get a good quality, accurate JPEG, then we'll have a good enough photo to work with and do our editing with as well. You just want to make sure that that JPEG is the largest size that you can get. So you often have different levels of resolution. You want to have as much resolution as possible. And you also want to have the best quality possible as well. So find those two settings in your image quality. They'll be in the main menu somewhere. And make sure that you're getting the highest resolution JPEG that you can. Same as we were talking about last night too. Best to use a self timer if you can as well, and to have your camera on a tripod. This is so that when we're pressing the camera, we're not accidentally moving it and causing anything to blur out. And by having a delay of 5 or 10 seconds or so, it also gives us a chance to hold up the sheet or hold up the reflector if we're doing this all by ourselves as well. So I typically will have mine on 10 seconds. That gives me enough time to fiddle around to do some other things. And it just means when we're getting to manual exposure, we'll be using some pretty long shutter speeds when we're shooting on a tripod. You know, sometimes if it's a really dark gallery, I might have a shutter speed of 15 seconds. And just the act of pressing the camera sometimes can cause a bit of blur. So self-timer fixes that. When we're shooting with JPEGs too, we also have these things called picture profiles. And picture profiles are profiles that the camera manufacturer adds onto the JPEGs for basically so the photo looks nicer for the end user. And this can be a good thing when we're photographing, you know, like landscapes or portraits, because we can get nice poppy colors, nice, you know, strong contrast, all these things that we associate with good photos. However, it doesn't work very well for artwork documentation, because with artwork documentation, we want an authentic and an accurate image. So the picture profile I would recommend shooting in is a neutral profile. Every camera should have a neutral profile. And what that'll give you is a low contrast image. So it'll help preserve your highlights and your shadows. And it'll give you authentic colors as well. And it's a good starting point that we can jump off and edit some of that contrast and colors back into down the track. It's much easier to add saturation and color back into a photo than it is to take it away. So we typically want to start with an image that's malleable. We typically want to start with an image that's malleable and then edit the colors and contrast back into it. If you do end up having a read into RAW and shooting RAW, these picture profiles won't affect the RAW image. They only affect the JPEG image. Now, another thing that is useful to change to is the focus area. So when we're shooting on the camera's default mode, what'll happen is it'll basically just use every focus point that it has available, and it might focus on this corner or that corner, or it often changes focus between different shots. I'd recommend limiting the focus area as much as possible. So choose a small central focus area or a single focus point and aim that in the middle of the artwork. Now, the only problem you might run into with this is that cameras need contrast to focus. So if you point it at an area that doesn't have much contrast there, it might struggle. However, you can move this focus point around. So move it to somewhere, you know, like a good point of contrast in this example would be the edge of the beer can here. All right, big difference between the edge of the painting and the wood itself. So the camera would have no trouble locking onto that. But you want to keep it as central as possible. And that's because with artworks, or with cameras rather, we control the range of focus with something called the aperture, which we'll talk a little bit more about in a second. I'm just going to draw a quick diagram for you. So if you imagine if this is your artwork, this line here, and this is your camera, a camera's focus on a plane. So, and you can't see the reflection very well there, but a camera basically focuses on a plane. And so if we're aiming in the middle of the artwork, it's going to mean that we're going to likely have this edge of the artwork and this edge of the artwork in equal focus. If the camera is slightly tilted, then the plane of focus actually cuts through the artwork. So it doesn't sit flush with it. Now, if we have, we're at the mercy of our camera's automatic focusing system and it chooses a focus point up the top here, say, then that slight angle may mean that the top half of the canvas or whatever is in focus, but the bottom half is completely out of focus. So by keeping the focus as centralized as possible, it reduces the risk and gives us a little bit less of a margin for error if our camera is slightly angled up or down. It's very, very hard to get a camera perfectly flat to your artwork unless you have really fancy equipment using things like lasers, which is beyond anything even I use when it comes to artwork reproduction. Now, there's also, we have white balance in the camera too. And this is what we use the gray card for. So I was talking about this last night as well, Sohu, but this is a gray card here. It's a calibrated neutral surface that we can use to, we can use it when we take the photo and also use it when we edit as well. Some cameras will have a custom white balance. I don't think yours will, Lee. It's a bit too old. So what you want to do instead is try using either auto white balance or some of the canned white balance settings. So you'll have like a daylight white balance and a cloudy sky white balance or a fluoro white balance. You just want to have a look at them and see which one works best for you. But whenever you're photographing artworks, you always want to take a photo of the artwork and then a photo of the gray card. And when we get into the editing stage, we'll take a reading off this gray card just to fine tune that white balance even further. What the white balance does is it tries to neutralize any colors that are coming out of our light source. So, you know, say our light source is actually 6,000 Kelvin rather than 5,000 Kelvin, the white balance will account for that little discrepancy between our light source and pure white neutral light. And we'll have a look at how we use that gray card tomorrow when we get into Lightroom as an editing suite. Now, we're shooting in manual mode. So when we're shooting in manual mode, we also need to be wary of our exposure. And there are a couple of different ways that we measure exposure. Two of those ways are histograms and highlight warnings. So some cameras, you'll have a live histogram that you can display on the screen, like I have with my camera here. And this will give us a live feedback of what's actually happening with the exposure. But for DSLRs, like your camera, Lee, you won't have a live histogram, but you'll be able to pull up a histogram after you've taken the photo. So you basically want to take a shot and then check your histogram. And I'll talk about how you do that in a sec. The other thing is a highlight warning. So these black blotches on the image here, these actually flash black when we're looking at the reviewed image. And that's telling me that those parts of the image are pure white. We always want to avoid pure white or pure black when we're capturing photos because it means that we've lost data. So on the wall here, that's not too much of a problem. But if I had flashing bits on my actual artwork itself, it would mean I'd need to tone down the exposure and make the photo a little bit darker. One more thing we need to talk about with the focal length. I typically will take photos around about 50 millimeters, but for zoom lenses, around about the middle of the range tends to be the sweet spot for your lenses. Because you have a crop sensor on your camera, Lee, I'm not going to get too much into the specifics of that, but you'd be looking at about 35 mil on your zoom lens. Okay, that would be what I would typically use to photograph my artworks, which is about halfway between 18 to 55, which is good. So I'd set that zoom on my artwork, and then I would physically move forwards and backwards until the artwork fills up as much of the frame as possible. It's always good to leave a little bit of space around the edges of the artwork, just so you know, we can crop in slightly once we get into the editing stage. But you want to fill up as much of the frame as you can, so you have as much resolution as you can in that image. All right, now let's get onto manual exposure. Basically, we've got three things that control our exposure: ISO, aperture, and shutter speed. These things work in sort of harmony. They both either let more light or less light into the camera. And I'm going to keep things simple today. I'm not going to really focus on what things are doing specifically, but we'll just talk about, I'll talk about the sort of the settings that you want to choose. We're going to lock two of these in and then only vary one of them to make life easier for ourselves. And we'll vary that one thing to either make our image brighter or darker. We monitor that exposure with the exposure meter and the histogram and the highlight warnings, which we talked about before. We want to aim for a bright image without losing highlights. Okay, so as bright as possible without actually getting to pure white. And depending on whether we're shooting handheld or with a tripod, there'll be a couple of different approaches we have to choosing this ISO, aperture, and shutter speed. What you want to do is just find where these are located in your camera system. So we've got the shutter speed here, aperture, and ISO on my camera system, but that'll be different for everyone. You also want to work out how you change these as well. This will be something that you'll need to look up in the manual, but it'll likely be using either a button or using one of the control wheels. Now, with handheld shooting, there are a couple of things we're going to lock in. We're going to lock in the shutter speed and we're going to lock in the aperture. There's a rule of thumb with handheld shooting, and that is you want to choose a shutter speed that's 1/2 times your focal length. And that will account with any of our own little jittery body movements that we might have ourselves that will cause our images to be blurred. So I said before I like to shoot with a 50mm lens. That would mean if I wanted to be completely safe, I would shoot with a shutter speed of 1/100 of a second. Okay? Now, if you've got really good technique, you can often go slower than this. I actually, if I'm feeling good, I can actually go down to about 1/4 of a second and still get a sharp photo, but it takes a little bit of practice. When you're hand holding a camera, what you wanna do, this is the same for if you're holding a phone too, actually. You wanna sort of grab the phone or the camera with both hands, get a good grip with both hands, and you wanna keep your arms tucked in. So we use our arms as a prop to help stabilize the camera. Worst thing you can do is sort of have it floating out here in the air, because it's very, very hard to keep things steady when you've got the camera like that out there. If you're using a dedicated camera too, you also want to hold it up to your eye, all right? So we've got one point of contact here, another point of contact there, and then a third point of contact with our eye. And that will go a long way with ensuring that your own body's movements aren't causing the image to be blurry. So we've locked in a shutter speed. We're also going to lock in aperture as well at f8. That will ensure that our image is sharp from corner to corner. And then the thing that we vary is the ISO. ISO controls how sensitive our camera's sensor is to light. So we either increase or decrease the ISO so that we achieve a good exposure. And we'll get to what a good exposure is in just a moment. If we're shooting on a tripod, slightly different methodology, we again set our aperture to f8, but this time we set our ISO to the lowest value that we can, which will be either 100 or 200, depending on your system. And then the one thing that we vary is the shutter speed. Reason for this is that if your camera's on a tripod, it doesn't matter if you've got a shutter speed of 1/500 of a second or 15 seconds, because the camera's on a tripod, there's not gonna be any problem with any sort of movement. For still works anyway. You know, if I was photographing a performance, for example, then this wouldn't work. But for things like framed paintings, you know, the journals you're working on, Lee, the shutter speed won't really matter at all if you've got your camera on a tripod. So those are the two methodologies to things, but what is a correct exposure? First thing is you can't trust your eyes. So don't look on the back of the screen and think that looks good. because camera screens are often deceptive, and it, depending on what environment we're shooting in, our eyes will make things look brighter or darker. We really need to go off measurement systems. And a good place to start is the exposure meter. So exposure meter is this little meter. It'll have positive numbers and negative numbers, and they're displayed in a couple of different ways. On my camera system, it's just a number-based system. But basically zero is what the camera says is the correct exposure. It's a good place to start, but exposure meters are highly inaccurate because what exposure meters assume is that what we're pointing towards is middle gray brightness, which is basically the same brightness as what this is here, our gray card. Now, this isn't practical for most situations. And you can see, like, if I move this closer, my webcam's on automatic exposure at the moment. So as I move this closer, the exposure goes brighter. As I move this further away, the exposure goes darker. So this isn't a great measurement for the real world. It's a good place to start, but it's not going to be perfect. And if you've got artworks that are light colored, then typically the exposure meter will give you underexposed or too dark photos. And if you've got artworks that are dark, the exposure meter will give you photos that are too bright. So we launch off from the exposure meter and go into things like the histogram. And what the histogram is a graphical representation of the tones in our image. On the left-hand side of the histogram, we have pure black, and on the right-hand side of the histogram, we have pure white. And then everything in between are different shades of gray. The height of those peaks in the histogram is the quantity of pixels we have at that level of brightness. So if we look at this histogram here compared to this photo, I've got one big peak, which is getting close to almost white. That would be the white wall. And then this other big peak here would likely be the wood. And then this color down here would be things like the yellow paint and the gray in that photo. And the more you study a histogram and the more you study your images, the better a feeling you get to the shape of this. But what you can see is that I've pushed that histogram as far to the right as possible without actually touching the right-hand side. All right, that's the goal. And there are some technical reasons why we always want to have a bright image, but basically you end up with more image data with brighter pixels than you do with darker ones. If this was too bright, then we would edit it back when it gets to something like Lightroom or Photoshop. And good, quick, easy way just to double check that you haven't reached pure white is with that highlight warning. So we can see here again, a camera says I've got a bit of pure white on here. My histogram actually tells me I don't have pure white. I find with my Sony camera, it's very liberal as to when it shows up that that highlight warning. But main thing is nothing on the actual artwork itself. So I know that I've maintained all the tones within the actual artwork. The wall doesn't matter so much. And then the last thing to always do is once you've taken a photo, just zoom in and make sure that it's actually sharp. Okay, so zoom in, move from, you'll be able to move where you've zoomed into and check from corner to corner, edge to edge, and just make sure that everything's tack sharp across that entire surface. If it is, you're golden. If it's a little bit blurry, then try taking the photo again and maybe just try fiddling with your settings a bit too. And that's the class. Thank you for listening. Any questions from that?